Please help me welcome Katha and Annie Laurie.
Well, it's an honor to sub for Lindsay, and I want to say what I've already told Katha many times, that your column, Subject to Debate, is a feminist touchstone for me, and I think for so many other women.
Thank you for saying that.
And I also wanted to say that reading Learning to Drive was one of the most fun reading experiences of my life. Aww. It's really fun and memorable and highly recommended. I'm so glad they did make it into a movie. They took a few liberties, but it was fun.
There are three lines that I wrote that are in the movie. Three.
So to warm up, the $64,000 question, how's it gonna go tomorrow? Do you wanna prognosticate, not necessarily on who's gonna win, but is there gonna be a double standard in how our candidates are judged?
That's such a fascinating question. I spend, you know, a lot of time worrying, like we all do. I go back and forth. I think that Matt Lauer was so criticized for his just blatantly disparate treatment of the two candidates when he did that the foreign policy. It wasn't a debate, but double interview, when he spent half the time quizzing Hillary using different words but the same question, like, what about those emails, and didn't correct any of the blatant falsehoods of Donald Trump, where he said he was always against the Iraq war, which isn't true. I think he got so much criticism for that from so many quarters that it will be, I'm hoping that the people in charge of this debate will not be as blatantly prejudiced as they otherwise would have been. But you never know, because they might be saying, the journalists are so weird that they might think, oh, these people are trying to tell me what to do. I'm not gonna do that. In fact, I'm gonna do the other even more. You just don't know. Now, there are a lot of rumors going around, and I wouldn't believe anything I read even in the New York Times or the Washington Post, where the different campaigns are talking about how they're going to prepare or not prepare, or what they're planning, what their strategy is. I think that's all put out to just confuse the waters and rattle the other side. So you probably have read that Donald Trump had invited Jennifer Flowers to be at the debate, the former putative girlfriend of, girlfriend of Clinton back in the 80s and 90s, early 90s. The latest is she's not gonna be there. Maybe Trump listened to Kellyanne Conway, his minder, and decided that was not a wise thing to do, because every married woman in America would be really mad at him if he did that. So I think it's really hard to tell. I find myself thinking, boy, I could never do this. I could never stand the pressure. What if you just don't sleep the night before? What if you have a cold? I was thinking, what if she loses her voice? She talks all the time. She has to give speeches, and you can sometimes, you know, people say, oh, I really hate her voice. Well, she, there's a lot of stress, vocal stress that she's undergoing, and a million things could happen. What if he has some momentary bout of sanity? That would be terrible. I think it's anybody. I'm almost scared to watch. You know, I mean, basically, I wish I could be put into a medical coma until election day, and then I'd go to the polls. But it is just so stressful. If you follow the polls, if you follow the news, there is just no way that you can feel calm. Even if you talk to a lot of political scientists who tell you, look, this is, I was just on a panel with a very expert political scientist, Gary Segura, who's a big pollster, and he was saying, you know, Hillary is exactly where people talk about how it's a bad campaign. No, she's exactly where she would be if she was any Democrat. And, you know, there are fundamental things that are at work, like the likelihood that the ruling party stays in power after two terms, all kinds of stuff like that. She's exactly where she should be. She's doing fine. Don't worry. And so that worked for about 15 minutes. Then I went back to worry. So anyone out here probably has as good an understanding of what's going on as anybody who's writing about it, unless they are just deeply, deeply into the scholarly material.
Now, just one follow-up question. Is there going to be a double standard in the way that Clinton is judged versus Trump? Is he going to be given a lot of passes?
Oh, well, I think the double standard is so baked in at an unconscious level that even the rules that look like they're neutral are not neutral. Let's take, for example, age. And you'll remember that Rush Limbaugh in 2008 said, you know, I don't think that people are going to want to watch her age in watch a woman age in public. Okay, so she's 68 and he is older than that, or maybe she's 67 and he's 69, or she's 68 and he's 2 years older than she is. And people never talk about, oh, the old man. You know, I don't want to watch him age in public. They make fun of his hair, which is truly comical. But they don't specifically talk about his age. Look at the way their health has been dealt with differently. I mean, it's incredible. She, you know, this whole pneumonia thing was blown up into a major story because it tied in with, oh, she's deceitful. Oh, she's secretive. She didn't announce on national television that she had pneumonia on Friday. And then she had this sort of little mini collapse on Sunday. Meanwhile, he gets a circus clown to write a letter saying, oh, he's the healthiest man in world history, and we're supposed to accept that. Then he goes on some talk show and discusses his health with another talk show person, Dr. Drew, or was it Dr.
Oz.
Drew? Dr. Which one was it?
Oz.
Dr. Oz, right, okay. And you know, this all just sort of, because he sets the bar so low, I feel like the media, even if they would like to be severely critical, there are not enough minutes in the day to do that, to catch up with him. And so he gets a pass on a lot of stuff that she doesn't. So I would say, coming down to the debate, yeah, when a man has a, I think someone wrote this in the Times today, when a man has a resting face, that's seen as serious, he's thinking. When a woman has a resting face, there is this thing called resting bitch face. And if you're not smiling, then it's like you're angry. And a woman being angry is the worst thing in the world. So I think it's so much of this happens at an unconscious level that it's very hard to constantly call it out. And a lot of it is quite subtle. But I would say when you have, in the latest poll that I saw in the Washington Post, when asked about, is it truthfulness or trustworthiness, some word like that, he is a point ahead of her. That's incredible. That, to me, I do believe that shows the failure of our media across the board, because there is just no metric by which he is more honest than she is. And, you know, if you look at PolitiFact, if you look at Jill Abramson, who investigated all these scandals, supposed scandals, when she was at the New York Times, she's a pretty honest for a politician. But she's been made to seem very dishonest and deceitful. And I do think, just to say one more thing, I do think that kind of plays into a very deep gendered double standard, which is power in a woman is somehow illegitimate. There used to be this phrase called petticoat government, back when women wore petticoats. And what that meant, petticoat government is when women run the show. And of course, they never do get to run the show. But so this was an idea that simultaneously ridiculed it and expresses a certain fear of it, and also is mobilized whenever a woman did seem to be getting anywhere. Like if women could get the vote, oh, then we'd have petticoat government. Think of Marie Antoinette. People don't even remember her husband's name. Marie Antoinette is like world famous, and that was because she was a woman who was perceived as cold-hearted and frivolous, and she was the power behind the throne. She wasn't the power behind the throne. It's ridiculous. But the idea that a woman should exercise power is a bad thing. She's going to do something bad with it. She's not statesmanlike. She doesn't have the rational, you know, wonderfulness of a man. And I think a lot of that comes into play with Hillary, and you see that, for example, in the obsession with her clothing, her appearance. Everything she does is scrutinized in a way that it would not be if she were a man.
Now, to change the topic to your book, Pro, Reclaiming Abortion Rights, you've pointed out that 1 in 3 U.S. women will terminate at least one pregnancy, that abortion is normal, but we treat it like it's something bad or we feel we have to apologize for it. And you have said, how can abortion come out of, you've said abortion needs to come out of the closet. How can we make that happen?
Well, I think that in Pro, I argue that we have to start talking about abortion as a normal part of women's lives, a normal part of healthcare. It always has been. This is not some new thing that is happening because people have suddenly become selfish or evil or more frivolous and bad than they have ever been. Women have abortions because they want to lead a rational life, because they're poor, they can't afford to have children, they have enough children. I'll just to digress a little bit, the two statistics that most surprise people when I've gone around the country talking about abortion. One is the one that almost 1 in 3 women will have had an abortion by menopause, at least one abortion by menopause, because people do think of it as a sort of rare thing that is done by sluts and cold-hearted career women and other bad women. They don't think of it as something that someone they know could have done, or someone who's in their family. And there are reasons for that that we can talk about, which is this related to the stigma. People don't talk about it, when their own abortions. And the second statistic that really surprises people is, and it's just gone out of, oh, I know, that 60% of women who've had abortions are mothers already. They've already had children. So the whole idea that, oh, well, before you have an abortion, you have to go to a crisis pregnancy center where they'll really explain to you what's going on in there, or you have to have an ultrasound and be, you know, and look at it and be read scripts about fetal development. These women know what pregnancy is. They have already been pregnant. They have delivered children. They are raising children. There really is nothing that needs to be told to them about the choice they're going to make. That they want to make. So people are very surprised to hear that, because they think of abortion and children as the opposite of each other, or abortion and motherhood. The woman who does one and the woman who does the other, these are completely different kinds of people. But no, it's the same woman at a different point in her life, facing different circumstances, and maybe a different kind of pregnancy too. So I think that, what was your question?
how can we get abortion out of the closet?
Oh, well, I think that, you know, an interesting thing was Pro came along at a moment when this is beginning to happen, that for a long time, the pro-choice movement was very reactive to the very aggressive anti-choice movement, and was saying a lot of things like, well, we have to keep abortion legal because, after all, rape, incest, life of the mother, and these are all very important, because there are a lot of abortions that happen for those reasons. But the majority of abortions do not happen for those reasons. They happen because of socioeconomic and personal reasons. And this was much harder for the pro-choice movement to talk about, because they were so busy defending the right to abortion, period, that they had to go to these extreme cases. But now, That's changing. Now, there, especially among younger pro-choice women, there's a lot more public discussion of one's own abortion. People are coming out of the closet and talking about it, and they're making videos of their abortions and writing articles about their abortions, and there are many websites now where you can tell your abortion story. Storytelling is the new big thing, not new like yesterday, but new in the past couple of years, the new big addition to the pro-choice armamentarium is telling abortion stories so that people will see, look, I'm a normal person, here were my circumstances, this is what I chose to do, and here's why, and here's how it worked out. I think that that's making a difference, especially among younger women. I think that realizing that you've got a lot of company and that life is messy and complicated and your life is too, and that's just the way it is, I think is all really, really important.
Now, even back in 1993, you wrote a column, Why Do We Romanticize the Fetus?, that got an Maggie Award from Planned Parenthood. Mm-hmm. And I know that was one of my mother's pet peeves as an early abortion rights leader, that she felt that the focus had to remain squarely on the women, and somehow the antis had been able to take the focus
yes.
off the women and onto the fetus.
Yes.
So why do we romanticize the fetus, and how can we stop that?
Well, like many articles that ask the question why, what the article really does is explain how. And in that article, which is, you know, old article now, I was so struck by all the ways, at that point, there were ads that would use, there was an ad for a car that was talking about its wonderful smooth ride, and it used a fetus in the womb. You know, you'll be like a fetus in the womb, so the woman is like a car. Then there was the comparison of the fetus to an astronaut, so the woman is like a space capsule. I think people talk a lot about the effect of ultrasound on the abortion debate. And I think one way that ultrasound has affected it is that it lets you, for the first time, you can see the fetus, but you can only see the fetus by erasing the woman. You can't see both at the same time. If you're looking at a pregnant woman, you can't see the fetus inside her, and if you're looking, but you know it's there, if you're looking at the ultrasound, you just see this kind of gray wallpaper. That's the woman. You don't even see her whole body, let alone her head. I think that in many ways we see the fetus, and even calling it the fetus is a kind of babification of the quote unborn unquote, because most abortions, like almost 90% of abortions, take place in the first 12 weeks of pregnancy, when for almost all of that, the fetus is really an embryo. And of course, anti-choicers want you to see a fertilized egg as a fetus, which is a baby, according to them. And now a fertilized egg is not a fetus at all. A fertilized egg is a little tiny, you know, mini-celled entity. A fetus has arms and legs and a head and all like that. A fertilized egg doesn't have any of that. It has no senses. It has no mind. It has none of the qualities of a baby. And it's this blurring backwards that the anti-choicers want to do so that you'll see the whole thing as a baby from the beginning. And that is because, and to do that, what they do is they define baby as the DNA. So you are your DNA. So just the way you know, you're just what you were when you were a fertilized egg. But that's not true either. I think that, you know, people sympathize with babies. People love babies, even if they hate babies. They in real life, they love them in the abstract, and they value. We place a very high value on babies. Make a big distinction between, in law, between having a miscarriage and committing negligent homicide on your baby or your 5-year-old. And this is all this is why it's very important for the anti-choicers to make this baby connection, because people know at some level that, you know, there's a ton of miscarriages, there's, every time you have a pregnancy scare, which almost all sexually active women have had, you know, you don't know if when your period is 10 days late, that's because a fertilized egg was flushed out for some reason. And I think most people don't want to start thinking about that. They don't, I mean, one of the things that's challenging about talking about abortion is people don't really want to talk about it. They don't want to talk about it for all kinds of reasons. It's, they don't want to fight with their friends. They don't want to be out of step with their community. It's all about women's yucky bodies, and they certainly don't want to think about that. And so it's very hard to get people to see abortion, this thing about seeing it as normal. It's very hard to do that when people won't have a frank conversation about it, and when it all comes down to, oh, but the baby. So those are some of the challenges.
Well, so speaking of not having a conversation about it, you start this book by the revelation that you realized, you learned, I believe, after your mother's death, that she had had an abortion.
Yes.
And had never talked to you about it.
Right. And that's true. My mother had an illegal abortion probably in 1960. This was so common. You know, that's another thing, another piece of disinformation from the anti-choice people, which is, it's a lie that illegal abortion was common. There was a conference in the 50s of demographers that Planned Parenthood held, and the only part that anti-choicers ever quote from that were the results of that conference were that at that time, most illegal abortion was performed by doctors. Now, that doesn't mean that they were safe, because not every doctor is a good practitioner, but it was not the case that every abortion was, you know, some mafioso in a hotel room, but that did exist, and so they use that to say, oh yeah, abortion, very safe, very safe. They make it illegal. I have debated pro-choice, pro-lifers who have said, you know, oh well, if they made abortion a crime, women would, yeah, okay, they'd have illegal abortions, but they would be safe thanks to vacuum abortion. Well, thanks a lot. You know, let's have heart surgery be performed in motel rooms too, there was this same demographic conference said, when asked, how many abortions do you think there are right now, the most common number that came up, I mean, nobody knows for sure because it was a crime, right, so you try to keep it secret, was around 1 million. Well, think how much less population there was in the 50s than now. It's the same number now. So there actually abortion, if that number is correct, was really a lot more common. So I think that when I think of my mother having gone through that experience, I feel so sorry for her. You know, I feel, you know, you have to go through that alone, to not really know who this person was. Or maybe, you know, maybe her friend steered her to, you know, the local doctor who was doing this after hours, because there was plenty of that too. But the whole, you know, it's a terrible, terrible thing to have to go outside the law to just protect your basic humanity.
Now, speaking of basic humanity, in Pro, you have a chapter, what is a person? And then you even ask, are women persons? The definition of personhood. Can we talk about that?
Well, it's very interesting, because what is a person? I find it hard to believe that a person includes someone that has no consciousness and never did, which would be a fetus, an embryo, a fertilized egg. I find it hard to imagine a person that doesn't have a head or any limbs or any internal organs. And you know, there's a lot of slippage between it's a life, it's a human life, it's a human being, and it's a person. Those are not the same, but there's a lot of slippage in the way we talk about abortion where personhood gets kind of smuggled in there. And what's interesting is that, and this gets into the way religion plays into the anti-choice movement, is you would think, okay, religion, they all think, oh yeah, it's a person from the moment of conception, it has a right to life. This isn't true. It's only some religions that think this. The Catholic Church thinks this. They're very big on that. Even the Southern Baptists don't go all the way. They would say that you could have an abortion to save your life, although they might not call it an abortion. They might call it, you know, a premature delivery or something like that. But the Catholic Church is, despite the best efforts of theologians to claim that they don't, Catholicism doesn't really say this, the bishops think it says this, the Pope thinks it says this. It wasn't even until the 1920s that it became okay to end an ectopic pregnancy in Italy. The gynecologists and obstetricians were begging the Pope, you know, tell us it's okay to end these pregnancies that cannot, you know, which is a pregnancy outside the womb in the fallopian tube. Tell us it's okay to end this pregnancy, which cannot yield a living baby and is definitely going to lead to the death of the mother. It took until the 20s before the Pope said, okay, you can do it. So they take that pretty seriously. But most religions, there's wiggle room. In Judaism, for example, if the woman's life is at risk, you have to have an abortion. She is the person. Until the baby is born, it's not the person. And in some parts of Judaism, it's not even a person for a couple of days after that. But what I talk about in the book, in addition to showing that, you know, God is not not so clear on all this, is that that if you really believe that the unborn is a person, then you have to be in favor of things that people are not in favor of, including most people who say they're pro-choice. Most people do make some kind of distinction. They say, okay, if her life is at risk, then you can have an abortion. Well, if my life is at risk, but I could drain Annie Laurie's blood and drink it, I can't do that. I can't take her kidney. I can't take her heart to save my own life. So if the picture of the unborn is, it's in the woman's body, but it's a completely distinct person. It's just kind of an accident that it's in there. Or as one anti-choicer said, famous anti-choicer said, all the fertilized egg needs to develop, to become a baby, is nourishment and time. And I'm thinking, oh, really? Nourishment and time? You feed it a bowl of oatmeal, you set a clock, and it's going to be a baby? No, it needs that woman's body. It needs her entire physical structure and her taking a risk with her health and her life. Just because a sperm happened to get in there. It is like seeing her like the space capsule or the car. So most people who are pro-choice, who are anti-choice, do make certain exceptions. Very few people in this country think, yes, if it's a choice between the woman's life and the fetus's life, we can't decide. It's just hands off. That's the Catholic position, hands off. That's maybe 7% of the population, which is tiny. You can get 7% of the population to believe anything, like they've been abducted by space aliens. So I think most people actually don't believe that the unborn is a person. What they do think is it's not nothing. That's what my father used to say. It's not nothing. And I think most people, including many pro-choice people, also think that. It's just when you have to make a choice, the choice goes to the woman, because she's the person who is taking that risk and will have to raise that child and all the rest of it. So I actually think that most people are kind of a little bit pro-choice. They don't like the idea that the woman gets to make the decision by herself. There's a in some of the literature, one of the pieces of literature that the pro-life secularists are handing out back there, there was a quote in, you know, the famous secularists who are anti-choice, and there was a quote from Christopher Hitchens. Now, I knew Christopher Hitchens. I knew him very well because he was my colleague at The Nation. And Christopher wrote one column where he basically said, you know, I'm against abortion. And that if we had, you know, good socialist provisions for women and children, this should, then we can make it illegal. And this was a quote from him in 2008 saying, well, I don't think it should just be the woman who decides. This is a social decision. I was thinking, well, for heaven's sakes, is society going to come die in childbirth? No. Is society going to have, you know, a cesarean that leaves her in all kinds of distress? No. I mean, do you know that 800 women die in America every year in childbirth? And more like 80,000 come pretty close. Childbirth is really serious. It's serious medically, it's serious psychologically, it's serious socially. And the idea that we're all going to sit and make some serious decision about whether this woman should be able to, should be forced to carry a child, no. Who else should make that decision? She gets to make that decision. It's her body. It used to be the husband got to make the decision, or her father got to make the decision, or her clan, or her family, or the whole society. Through law. Well, that was really bad. This is better. Long answer to a simple question.
Not such a simple question, but following up on that, you've also said we think we value mothers in America, but we don't. Do you want to just elaborate?
Oh, it's so true. I mean, you know, I spent the last year in Austria, living in Austria. Austria is a country with a lot of problems. You might have read about some of them in the paper. And yet, when it comes to their social welfare system, is really good. It's really good. And if you have a baby in Austria, it's a whole other story than if you have a baby here. For one thing, they have a very good healthcare system, and it covers everybody. You have all kinds of paid parental leave, prenatal care, postnatal care. You can have a nurse come to your house every day and see that everything's okay. It's structured in a way that kind of assumes that women are going to step back at work, which is not a good thing. But in terms of just providing for the basic well-being of women, of mothers and children, it is like night and day here, there and here. And you know, when people say, oh yeah, like Christopher, oh well, we've got to have, you know, socialism, and of course we have to take care of women and children, what they miss is we not only don't do that, we do increasingly less of that in a lot of states. I mean, consider even something as basic as the Medicaid expansion that is possible under Obamacare, under the Affordable Care Act. Any state, thanks to the Supreme Court, can but doesn't have to accept an expansion of Medicaid to cover the people between those who are desperately poor and those who don't reach the threshold for Obamacare. And I think now it's 19 states, but I could be wrong about that, that have just said, no thanks, this is free money. This is free money to take care of poor people, and it's not as if those poor people don't incur other costs, that not covering people is also a cost. But they just said, no, we don't want to do that. And these are disproportionately, of course, they're all red states, and they're disproportionately states in the South that have set the bar very, very low. Or, you know, you have to be really, really poor before you get Medicare and Medicaid and other social benefits there. So basically, there are just millions of women, it's disproportionately black women, Hispanic women, who they have said, you know, we're not going to give you anything. We don't want you to be healthy. And that is why Texas's rate of maternal mortality doubled in the last couple of years. They decided to destroy their reproductive health care system so that they wouldn't have to give any money to Planned Parenthood. But they said, that's okay, we're going to replace all that with, you know, regular clinic, general clinics and stuff like that. But they kind of didn't do that. And so people don't get continuity of care. They will get care while they're pregnant and for a little bit after delivery. And that's it. But we all know that health is not just something that happens, you know, maternal health is not something that just happens while you're pregnant. It's also the continuity of care and the general level of your well-being that it requires continuous medical care. And they don't get that, to say nothing of the fact that they're incredibly poor. Then take welfare reform. That's also a way of not respecting mothers. That's a way of saying, you know, the work you do for pay, we value that. The work you do for not pay, even though if you all decided not to have children, we'd all be in big trouble, that doesn't count. So I see no way in which motherhood is valued in the society. Women lose their jobs all the time when they get pregnant or when they have kids, and even though those things are not supposed to happen, they do all the time. One thing, I'll just say one more thing that's really interesting is like the whole, you know, oh, motherhood, it's so sacred, children, they're so sacred. The minute you have the baby, that completely drops away. While you're pregnant, everybody's saying, oh, this is so important. When you have a baby, oh, why did you do that if you couldn't support it? And there is actually a famous economist, I think it's Mankiw, who wrote on his blog, and I talk about this in the book, he says, just explain to me, because he's at Harvard, I don't get this. Why is having a baby different than buying a Porsche? You know, we would never say everyone has to support me to get a fancy sports car. Why does everybody have to support you if you have a baby? I don't get it. Can you explain this to me? I mean, that is sort of a moment where you think, you know, there are some things men really just don't understand. It's true. I find it hard to think a woman would say that, but there probably are women who say that. But that whole idea of like, it's your baby, you know, it's just your individual personal decision, like to buy a car, to buy a fancy car, and so society owes you nothing. This is a very common and libertarian, quote unquote, point of view. So I
think we're out of time,
but I think
we have 1 minute. No, just in 1 minute, could you talk about your own atheism? I mean, you were coming out of the closet when it wasn't hip and trendy. We're talking about early 90s when it was really hard to find writers who were even identifying as atheists, and you've gone out of your way to do that. Just briefly, why?
Well, I think it's important that that view be represented in the public sphere. I think there are a lot of private atheists. There are a lot of people who don't think about it one way or the other. Like my husband, he's an atheist too, but he doesn't really care, you know? He just says, I'm religiously unmusical. I just don't get how anybody can believe in God. But it's not something he's going to make part of his identity because it's not interesting to him. Other things are interesting to him. But to me, it's always been interesting. And I think the reason is I had to go to chapel every day in elementary school and high school. I had to sing all those hymns. I had to sit there while they said the Lord's Prayer. I had to say the Pledge of Allegiance with under God in it, but I didn't say under God. And so for me, atheism always had that kind of antagonistic element, but for a lot of people it doesn't have that, so it just doesn't matter to them. But to me, it matters.
Thank you.